changed by now? Have you cried all the faith you had through so many tears? Don't forget the things that he's done before. And remember he can do it all once more. It's like the brightest sunrise waiting on the other side of the darkest night. Don't ever lose hope, hold on and believe. Maybe you just haven't seen it, just haven't seen it yet. You're closer than you think you are. Holy moments from the break of dawn. All these promises are just up ahead. Maybe you just haven't seen it, just haven't seen it. Like the brightest sunrise waiting on the other side of the darkest night. Don't ever lose hope, hold on and believe. Maybe you just haven't seen it, just haven't seen it yet. You're closer than you think you are. Holy moments from the break of dawn. All these promises are just up ahead. Maybe you just haven't seen it, just haven't seen it yet.
Bingo! shall pierce the night.
Воскреснув всякий мира, прикован взгляд к лицу Христа.
I'm doing something a little bit different here. I'm actually on the Sea of Galilee. If you look behind me on the mountain, that's the city of Tiberias. Right across the sea right here is where Jesus cast out the demons. Over behind us here is where we have Capernaum. We were there just a little bit ago, and I thought I would do something different and actually do my sermon here on the sea. I don't know if you know this, but it is actually Join the Hands Day. And you're sitting there and you're going, yeah, that's it. I wanted to celebrate this. I knew that day was coming. Or let's go have a barbecue. Maybe let's go have some balloons and some streamers. And maybe we'll go to a beach like this and sit around and sing Kumbaya. Okay, I joke. But it actually is a day. A Join the Hands Day is something that came about in 2000, and its purpose was to bring people and other organizations together from all over the world for the betterment of society at large. The main aim was to look at how we can unite people, young and old, and bring them together for a common purpose. You know, I don't think we as a church should necessarily celebrate Join the Hands Day, or maybe we can, but I think that every Sunday we should be in a attitude of how can we be encouraging one another? How can we be joining hands, maybe not so much physically, but spiritually, and working together for the betterment of His kingdom? See, I wanted to kind of deviate from our series on John, and I wanted to take a little bit of time this month to talk about a celebration. Today I want to talk about celebration diversity. We're going to talk about celebrating leadership. We're going to celebrate moms. We're going to celebrate Pentecost. But let's just talk about what it means to celebrate diversity together. And you know, I got to tell you, what I think is so cool that it doesn't matter what what background we come from, what a nationality, what skin color. We are all one in Jesus. And I think that's so important we realize that. And I want to take time to look at a portion of scripture that kind of focuses on that. And that's found in Ephesians chapter 2. Ephesians chapter 2, verses 11 to the end. It says this: "Therefore remember that formerly you who were Gentiles by birth and called uncircumcised by those who call themselves the circumcised, you that done in the body by the hand of men. Remember that at that time you were separated from Christ, excluded from citizenship in Israel and foreigners to the covenants of the promise, without hope, without God in the world. But now in Christ Jesus, you who are once far away have been brought near through the blood of Christ. For he himself is our peace, who has made the two one and has destroyed the barrier, the dividing wall of hostility, by abolishing in his flesh the law with its commandments and regulations. His purpose was to create in himself one man out of the two, thus making peace, and in this one body to reconcile both of them to God through the cross, by which he put to death their hostility. He came and he preached peace to you who were far away and peace to those who were near. For through him, we both have access to the Father by one Spirit. Consequently, you are no longer foreigners and aliens, but fellow citizens with God's people and members of God's whole household, built on the foundation of the apostles and prophets, with Christ Jesus himself as a chief cornerstone. In him, the whole body is joined together and rises to become a holy temple in the Lord. And in him, you two are being built together to become a dwelling in which God lives by his Spirit." Let's pray. Father, I thank you for your word. I thank you for this incredible, incredible place. And as we look at this whole concept of being one in you, Lord, speak to us clearly, is my prayer in your name. Amen. Amen. When it comes to celebrating diversity, we got to start with understanding separation. He says, you were formerly Gentiles by birth. You were called the uncircumcised. In other words, there was a time that these people were not part of the body. See, the early church was made up mostly of Jewish people. And the message of Jesus, it began to spread. It went all over the world. It started in this general vicinity. And it went far into all different places of the world, and most of the new believers in the church that of Ephesus that this was written to were not Jews, they were Gentiles. And listen, the Jews, they didn't like the Gentiles at the time. They didn't like them one bit. They looked different, they acted differently, they didn't have the same clothing and all that stuff, and so they just didn't belong and they weren't accepted. And you know, I gotta tell you, there's something about being accepted. There's something about when you feel you don't belong. I remember years ago, Michelle and I, we went to our grad reunion, my grad reunion. And, you know, I was thinking about high school and my time at high school. And you know, I was always an outcast. But I wanted to go to this reunion because my friend, my very good friend, Eric, he was going to be there. And I hadn't seen Eric in a lot of years, but we were really, really close in high school. So we get to this reunion, and it was what you expected. All the cliques formed once again. The people that were close in high school came together once again. And I was looking for Eric. And Eric walked in. Poor Michelle. She felt so out of place. But Eric walks in, and I was so excited. Eric is here. So I went up to Eric, and I said, "Hey, Eric, how's it going? Good to see you." And he answered by just simply saying, "Hey, Wes," turns around and he walks away. I basically got up after that and walked out. I thought, man, not even my good friend accepted me. There's something about not feeling accepted. Hey, listen, have you ever felt left out? Have you ever felt that you aren't accepted? I want you to know that regardless of where you come from, regardless of who you are, God loves you and you are accepted into his family. And the Gentiles themselves, they felt pushed out, or they were very much pushed out. And they were, first of all, it says that they were without Christ. Verse 12 says, "Remember that at time you were separated from Christ, excluded from citizenship in Israel and foreigners in the covenant of promise. Without Christ, they worshiped the goddess Diana. They knew nothing about Jesus. It was a religious, a religion of works. You know, as I've been here in Jerusalem in Israel and so forth, I realized, I've watched how people know so much about the Bible. Our guide, he knows so much about the Bible, and people have such a strong connection to history and so forth, but there's so few that have a connection to Jesus. We had a Messianic Jew come speak to us and talk about how difficult it is for him as a person, let alone a pastor in this area, to believe and to hold to his faith. People are so foreign from Jesus, and in our own area as well. See, there are lots of people that are without Christ around us. These people at this time were without citizenship. We're not talking about citizenship of Ephesus or Rome or citizenship like us of Surrey, but these people had no citizenship that the Jewish people had at the time, citizenship of heaven. Listen, you know, count yourself blessed if you are a believer and you have Jesus in your life, because you have hope, you have a future, you have eternity waiting for you. I've done this funeral here just recently for Brock. Brock was 41 years old. 41 is too young. It is way, way too young. And not long before he passed away, his wife, Christine, was talking to him, and I had a chance to talk to him as well, and saying, Brock, you got to accept Jesus. And not long before he passed away, he committed himself to the Lord. And I thought, you know, I am so glad he did, because I can tell you this, eternity is a very, very long time. And to enter into eternity without Jesus it's not just a shame, it's disastrous. So it's so important that we have our citizenship in heaven. These people were without citizenship, and they were without a covenant. A covenant is a contract or agreement between two parties. See, God made a very strong covenant at the time between his people and himself, a covenant of promise that he will reveal himself to his people, he will show them kindness, he will show them favor, and he will bless them. And yet these people that Paul was writing to here in Ephesus, they didn't have that same covenant, that same promise. They were removed from that promise. And you know, I see how strong covenant is here, how strong the importance is of that promise that God has made to this people. But these people were without covenant, and they were without hope. History tells us that there was a great cloud of hopelessness over the ancient world. The philosophies at the time were empty. The traditions were disappearing. Religion was powerless, and there was such a lack of hope. You can do all the right things, but if you don't have hope in the future, hope in God and what he has for us, it's empty, isn't it? And these people were without hope, but there was reconciliation. God brought them, or was about to bring them, to himself, as Paul talked about here. You know, right after World War II in 1945, there was a family in England that had four boys. And the youngest, Jeff, was only 1 year old. All four boys, their mom had died, and dad, he already had three boys, and he had this one little guy who's only 1 year old, and he thought, man, I can't handle this guy. So he gave him up for adoption. And Jeff was then given up for adoption to a family in Australia. 77 years later, Jeff found out that he had a brother, Ted, and they were reunited in Australia, as you can see in this picture. Ted here is 83 years old. It's a heartwarming story of how a family once again came together after so many years of being separated. Here's what it says in Ephesians 2, verse 13. 13. Once you were far away from God, but now you have been brought near, or you have been reconciled through the blood of Jesus. See, sin is a big separator, isn't it? It keeps us apart. It keeps us apart from the biggest relationship of all, and that's the relationship with God. It separates us from Him, but we have been brought near through the blood of Christ. I love what it says in verse 14. He Himself is our peace, who has made the two one and has destroyed the barrier, the dividing wall of hostility, by abolishing in His flesh the law and its commandments and regulations. In the time of Abraham, God made a difference between the Jews and the Gentiles. He made a distinction. But here He says, man, though there was that distinction, and it had become greater and greater, that distinction, and people had truly separated themselves from each other, Jesus came to take away that wall, but not just to take away the wall of hostility between the Jews and the Gentiles, but between us and everyone around us. Archaeologists have discovered the inscription on Herod's tomb, and it read this: no foreigner may enter within the barricade which surrounds the sanctuary and enclosure. Anyone who is caught doing so will himself to be blamed for his ensuing death. In other words, if they came into the presence of God, they were killed. They were not allowed into the temple. How sad, eh? How sad that there was this wall. But God says, enough is enough. His purpose was to create for Himself, as Scripture says, a new man. He wanted to make us one in Him. That's what I love about the fact of faith, is that we who were far away can be brought together. When Jesus died, that separation between us and God, the separation between us and one another, that was broken. We were at the tabernacle when we first came into Israel, and we saw this incredible veil that separated the most holy place and the holy place. And I just think back of that day when Jesus died and that veil was torn. What an incredible symbolism of an openness between us and God, that we could enter into His presence. And the same way, we can have a relationship between us and God. But what has separated us is sin. And you know, I want you to really consider where you are at with God. If there still is that separation between you and Him. I read about a man who stopped by a pastor's office one day, and he said to him, he needs help. He says, you're having problems with his wife. And he says this, his words were this: my wife and I need reconciliation. And the pastor chuckled, and he said, well, it's really reconciliation. But what a good word that really is. Recancellation. We need to recancel the debts, the sins, the things that we've done towards each other, and once again be reconciled to God. One commentary says this: a God of love wants to reconcile the sinner to Himself, but a God of holiness must see to it that sin is judged. God solved the problem by sending His Son to be the sacrifice for our sins, therefore revealing His love and meeting the demands of His righteousness. It was truly a recancellation. That brings me to my last point, and that is unification. In verse 14, Paul, he says that we have been made one in Christ, and here he elaborates by saying that we are one family. Verse 19 says, consequently, you are no longer foreigners and aliens, but fellow citizens with God's people and members of God's households. Now listen, aliens weren't some green man or whatever. Of course not. Aliens meant that we were not part of the same family, that we were separated, and we were all in a situation that we didn't have that relationship. But God wanted us to be part of His family. Verse 4 says, there is one body, one spirit, just as you were called to one hope when you were called, one Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father of all, who is over all and through all and in all. He wants us to be one. He wants you and I to be one. He wants our the Christian family to be one. He wants us to be one with Him, and He's brought us together as one family. He made us one temple. Verse 20 says, built on the foundation of the apostles and prophets through Christ Jesus Himself as the chief cornerstone. In Him, the whole building is joined together and rises together to become a holy temple in the Lord. And in Him, you too are being built together to become a dwelling in which God lives by His Spirit. See, in the book of Genesis, God walked with His people. In Exodus, He decided to dwell with His people. When we were at the tabernacle just a few days ago, one of the things that our guide there at the tabernacle said was very interesting. He said the tabernacle, which was the original place of worship when the Israelites were moving through the desert, it was hidden behind a large curtain. The average person never ever saw the tabernacle. They saw the presence of God, but ultimately the tabernacle wasn't about a building. The tabernacle was about a relationship you and I have with God. And unfortunately, David and Solomon, they saw the many tabernacles and the buildings around them to the other gods, and they built a structure. So the attention was then directed to the structure and not to the God that they are to be worshipped. Unfortunately, we do that sometimes as well. We get focused on stuff, and we fail to realize the wonders of the one who's created it all. At the Wailing Wall, when we were at the Wailing Wall, we see these people that are bowing down to the wall and are so overwhelmed by the structure. Folks, the truth is the tabernacle, that the temple is you and me. This is where God dwells. He dwells inside of us, and we need to focus on Him, not on any structure. So it's so important that we understand that the new temple was built on people, on the apostles and the prophets, and with Jesus as being the chief cornerstone. And I want us to make sure that we understand our responsibility when it comes to every person's responsibility in the whole realm of the temple, that you and I have a part to play when it comes to how we treat one another, that we understand that God gave some to be the hands, the feet, all of these different places within the structure of the temple. You've got a part to play. And see, that's why diversity is so beautiful. Because you may be a hand, you may be one brick, you may be one block or whatever. Please, I'm not trying to belittle you, but you may have a part to play in the temple, in the body. And that's awesome. As great as it may be, or as small as it may be, rejoice in your part in the temple. Celebrate your part in the temple. I've heard many times that the church is a melting pot. I don't like that. I don't like that. I like the fact that the church needs to be a stew. Not that you're stewing over things, okay? But I like the idea that the church is to be a stew. What that means is that, and man, we've had some great food here in Israel, and especially the stews, they would have many different items in that pot, and every little item brings a different flavor. There's the meat, there's the carrots, there's the tomatoes, whatever they put into that pot. They all are individual, and they all bring an individual flavor. You and I, we need to be individuals. We need to bring our individual flavor into the whole. See, God has called us to be a diverse church. God has called us to be different than one another, but to celebrate those differences, to celebrate the diversities, to not allow things to be set up that would interfere with a relationship with each other, but to make sure that He becomes the focal point of our lives. So I want to encourage you. I encourage you to make sure you have a good commitment with the Lord, that you have a wonderful commitment with each other, relationship with each other, and that we celebrate the diversity that God has created. Father, thank you again for this place. Thank you for bringing us to such an incredible moment where we can stop and consider your goodness and how, though that we are different, yet, Lord, in you we are one. Help us to be one in you, to rejoice with each other, to celebrate each other, and Father God, to celebrate the fact that you have given, made a way for us to have a relationship with you through your Son, Jesus. Lord, you are good. We give you all the praise in your name. Amen, amen. I'm going to end by just showing you around a little bit and letting you see some of the areas around me. And I wish you God's very, very best as we enjoy this land together. Back there is Capernaum, where Jesus spent most of his time. Back across the lake, where the sun is rising, is where Jesus, he drove out the demons into the pigs. And this is the other side of the lake with the city of Tiberias up there on the mountain. Sea of Galilee. Section of land, actually, when you consider how many miracles Jesus did, and they were all done in a very small area here, just on the shores of the Sea of Galilee. God bless you. Thank you for joining me. Wish you God's very, very best as we go into this day.